Aloha, everyone. I'm Irmina Van Dyken, MD, from Out of the Doldrums. Today, we're going to talk about a topic that's been pretty popular on this channel, nitric oxide, nasal breathing, and humming. We've talked about this topic for quite a while. I'll link some of those videos we've done in the past on this topic in the description below. Today, we're going to bring athletic performance into the picture, and we're going to ask the question, can we improve our athletic performance just by how we breathe? Does it make a difference if we breathe through our mouth versus our nose when we exercise? What about if we were to hum before exercise? What about prevention of exercise-induced nasal congestion, a common affliction of athletes? Is there any science behind this? I hope you're excited. I certainly am. Come along, let's further explore this topic. We all want to be better athletes, and sometimes breathing can be a barrier to this. When most people undergo vigorous exercise, they find themselves breathing through the mouth, just to catch their breath. Many people think you have to breathe through your mouth to be able to deliver oxygen to our muscles and our tissues that are working oh so hard. This was examined and demonstrated in this study published by Velli titled, Oronasal Airway Choice During Running. Ugh, what a title. Basically, he studied 984 subjects who participated in a 10K run, and he found that only 3 breathed through their nose when they ran. That's like 0.3%. This means 96.3% breathe through their mouth and their nose. He also found that 2.3% of the runners opened and closed their mouths rhythmically with breathing. Another study found that most individuals will spontaneously switch from predominantly nasal breathing to oral breathing as exercise intensity increases. This makes sense. Anyone who's worked out knows how difficult it is to breathe through their nose and not feel short of breath, especially when you're working hard. So we know from this research that most people transition to mouth breathing as the exercise gets more intense. Is this optimal? Or is there a better way to breathe, such as nasal breathing or breathing through our nose? Many proponents of nasal breathing during exercise provide the following as rationale as to why nasal breathing could be a better thing. First, nasal breathing filters the air so allergens and foreign bodies are less likely to enter the lungs. Second, nasal breathing adds moisture and warmth to the air, which results in smooth entry of air into the lungs. Third, here's where it gets really interesting. To me at least. Nasal breathing is thought to allow for more oxygen to get to active tissues. How would that work? Okay, so breathing through the nose increases nitric oxide release. This increases carbon dioxide release in the blood. When this happens, it releases oxygen that's used through the tissues that need it. When we breathe through our mouth, we don't release nitric oxide, so this process doesn't occur as efficiently and less oxygen gets to the cells that need them. Less oxygen to exercising tissues means more lactic acid buildup, fatigue, as well as muscle soreness and stress. This is all well and good, but is there really any science behind it? In regards to nasal breathing and nitric oxide release, there's plenty of good science on this, and I've made some videos on the topic too. They're linked below. But what about real-life examples like nasal breathing in athletes? There's not too much out there. Here's an article published in the International Journal of Kinesiology and Sports Science in April 2018. It's titled, Effect of Nasal versus Oral Breathing on VO2 Max and Physiological Economy in Recreational Runners Following an Extended Period Spent Using Nasally Restricted Breathing. Another long title. This study recruited 10 runners and spent 6 months training them to use nasal breathing only during exercise. They were studied while both nasally breathing and orally breathing. Researchers found that the rate of oxygen consumption did not change with nasal breathing versus mouth breathing. But they did find that nasal breathing during exercise had some benefits, like a lower respiratory rate, meaning less breaths per minute, and a lower ratio of oxygen and carbon dioxide output during nasal breathing. At the end of the day, a lower respiratory rate meant more time for oxygen to get to the tissues that so desperately needed it. The authors did stress that the runners had to train and adapt to exercising while nasally breathing. It took time to make that change. The paper concluded that, quote, a nasally restricted breathing pattern may be successfully utilized by recreational runners as a means of improving health without sacrificing performance ability, following an extended period of time spent adapting to this practice, end quote. This is good news, but it should be emphasized that special training was required to get to that point. For the average human, it's a doable thing, but it requires plenty of hard work in order to adapt to that condition. Besides the training, patience, and time needed to adapt, what else could stop athletes from nasal breathing? It's interesting. Many athletes suffer from chronic nasal congestion. Actually, anywhere from 15 to 47% deal with the problem. And yes, there are things we can take to relieve the congestion, like antihistamines, decongestants, and nasal sprays. But do we really want to take these things on a long-term basis? Steroid nasal sprays, for example, they've got a 5 to 48% risk of nasal bleeding as a side effect. And decongestant sprays can cause a condition called rhinitis medicamentosa if they're used longer than 5 days. It's basically a rebound congestion, worsening congestion, and swelling of the nasal passageways. So essentially, you get the opposite effect of what you were taking the decongestant spray for in the first place. So clearly, it's better, if at all possible, to treat or prevent the nasal congestion without the medication or the side effect. Also, something called exercise-induced nasal congestion is pretty common in athletes. According to this study published in the European Medical Journal, anywhere from 24 to 74% of athletes are affected by exercise-induced nasal congestion. This is explained physiologically by the fact that when we exercise, the blood vessels in the nose vasoconstrict or shrink down. This creates more volume in the nasal passages to facilitate more airflow. The problem with doing this to create more airflow is that it can lead to inflammation, which causes a clogged or runny nose during exercise. And sometimes this can last for up to 15 minutes after the exercise session has ended. Another thing that we see in regular exercise is exercise-induced bronchospasm. Basically, spasming down and narrowing of the airways. And the condition is caused by exercise. It's kind of like asthma, but only caused or triggered by exercise. Even in this, there's good research showing that nasal breathing during exercise actually decreases the chance of this bronchospasm happening. This study, for example, looked at 12 individuals who suffered from exercise-induced asthma and noted that, quote, when breathing through the nose during exercise, an almost complete inhibition of the post-exercise bronchoconstrictive airway response was noted, end quote. So the nasal breathing technique was found to almost completely prevent exercise-induced bronchospasm. Pretty cool stuff. If only there is a way we could decrease nasal congestion and increase nasal breathing during exercise. I wish we had more science on this, like a study done on humming prior to working out and whether it affects nasal congestion and ultimately athletic performance. We know from prior studies done on humming that it increases nasal nitric oxide concentrations. By the way, be sure to check out the video links below for more about humming and nitric oxide. Humming at a frequency of 130 hertz can increase nitric oxide concentrations in the nose by up to 15 times. We also have a case report of humming improving chronic sinusitis and nasal congestion in a man who hummed for 1 hour daily. So it's plausible and actually quite likely that humming immediately before exercise could decrease congestion and bronchospasm and increase nitric oxide release as well as improve athletic performance. Seems like a win-win to me. While we don't have studies on nasal breathing and humming immediately prior to exercise and how it relates to congestion, I did come across two studies reviewing a device that reduces nasal congestion with acoustic vibration. This device, called the Sinusonic, uses acoustic vibration and oscillating expiratory pressure to reduce nasal congestion. Sounds interesting. When reviewing the studies, it seems like there really might be something to this. For starters, the acoustic vibration frequency is 128 hertz. That's close to 130 hertz, which seems to be the optimal frequency for releasing nitric oxide from the sinuses. For a deep dive on this, check out the video I did on this topic. It's also linked below. This device also adds a positive expiratory pressure by way of a flutter valve, which we know can increase lung volumes. The first study recruited 14 patients who reported moderate to severe nasal congestion. They then had each participant rate their nasal congestion and ease of breathing on a 10-point visual analog scale before and after Sinusonic use for 2 to 5 minutes. At the beginning of the study, all 14 participants reported severe nasal congestion. Interestingly, after just one use of the device, All patients reported improvement in their nasal congestion, and all but one subject reported improved breathing after use. The second study was larger. It had 40 subjects. For this study, researchers actually used a procedure called rhinoscopy, where a small, flexible camera is used to visualize the nasal tissues. They also utilized multiple questionnaires to get a better understanding of the subjective improvements seen. My favorite questionnaire was rather appropriately named the SNOT-22 questionnaire. This study found significant subjective and objective improvements in nasal congestion after both 2 and 5 weeks of twice-daily use. So they're good studies, but they're quite limited. There were no placebos, no randomized controlled trials, which us science nerds know are the best. At the end of the day, we need more research. In the interim, it may be reasonable to try a protocol of either humming immediately before exercising or working on adapting to nose breathing, or both. Be patient. It took the athletes in that one study 6 months to adapt to nasal breathing during exercise. Also, maybe give the Sinusonic a try. It just might help open the nasal airways up enough to prevent that congestion, and it likely will increase nitric oxide concentrations in the airways enough to make a difference during exercise. Lucky for us, Sinusonic has graciously agreed to give a 10% off discount for viewers just like you. Here's the discount code, and I'll put it in the description below as well. And be sure to let me know if any of the above techniques work for you, or if you have any other strategies that help you get your breathing in order and help you with athletic performance. I really do want to know your experiences with breathing and with the Sinusonic if you try it. I want to know if it helps you with your exercise goals. All right, it's a wrap. I hope you enjoyed this super informative video. Please comment below with your questions and thoughts on the information provided today. If you like this video, please give it a thumbs up. If you want to show us some real support and help us to grow, subscribe to our channel. Until next time, stay safe, stay healthy, and aloha.